Hello again. So we are at the end of the first unit of the 5 units in this course on the essentials of MOSFETs. So what I'd like to do now is to just quickly go over what we've been talking about in the various lectures in this unit, just so that you're sure as you review the material what the key points are that you should take away from all of these discussions. So we'll do this quickly, but they're just, my goal is just to alert you to the topics that are the most important that you should spend your time reviewing. So we've primarily in this unit been thinking about the transistor as a black box and talking very little about the physics of what actually goes on inside this black box. That's what the whole course is all about. That's what we will be doing in the next unit and in all of the following units. Now, we take a transistor, which generally has three terminals. We like to think of it as a two-port device. It's got an input port and it has an output port. In order to have two leads on the input and two on the output, there's one terminal that has to do double duty. We can configure these circuits as common source, common gate, or common drain. You know, we've just done one illustration here where we've had the source terminal be common between the input and output. So the input in this configuration is the gate to source voltage. The output is the drain to source voltage. The output current is the current through the drain. And we talked about two different ways that we can plot the IV characteristics. We can plot transfer characteristics. A transfer characteristic is a plot of the drain current versus gate to source voltage at a fixed drain to source voltage. So we're plotting output current versus input voltage at a fixed output voltage. Now we can also plot the output characteristics. The output voltage is the output current versus the output voltage at a fixed input voltage. So these are called output characteristics. So try to be familiar when I refer to transfer characteristic of a MOSFET or output characteristic of a MOSFET. Be sure you understand what I'm talking about. The output characteristics have this classic look of transistors. This is what transistors look like. They have output characteristics like this. There is a critical voltage that divides these characteristics into two regions. If the drain voltage is small, then we're at the linear regime. If the drain voltage is large, then we're in the saturation regime. Each one of these lines on the characteristic refers to an increasing value of the gate voltage as we step the gate voltage up. Now, we could also plot the transfer characteristics, output current versus input voltage, and we could do it at a low voltage on the drain or at a high voltage on the drain. If we do it at a low voltage, we get a characteristic that looks like this. If we do it at a high voltage, not surprisingly, we get more current. We have a characteristic that looks like this. The current begins to flow when the gate to source voltage is bigger than a critical voltage, known as the threshold voltage. Okay. So, we then talked a little bit about what makes a transistor useful in a digital circuit. In a digital circuit, we're thinking about the transistor as operating as a switch that is either turned on or off by the gate voltage. And then we talked about the basic circuit for CMOS technology, CMOS logic, which couples an N-channel transistor and a P-channel transistor. The N-channel transistor has its source connected to ground, its drain connected to output, its gate connected to the input. The P-channel transistor has its gate also connected to the input, its source connected to the most positive voltage in the circuit, and its drain is also connected to the output. So the two drains are connected together, the two gates are connected together, the two sources are connected at different points. The ideal transfer characteristic has this shape that we called, that we described, and we can simply understand that by the NMOS and PMOS switching on and off. Real characteristics, if it's a good inverter, it has a very steep, narrow transition in voltage from the high voltage to the low voltage. Very important, these circuits have noise margins. There's regions over which the output voltage is insensitive to the precise value of the low input voltage, or where the low output voltage is insensitive to the precise value of the high input voltage. Those are essential to make digital circuits work so that errors do not accumulate. And the steepness of this characteristic is a measure of the voltage gain. dB out or dB in. It's how much the output voltage changes when the input voltage changes. The magnitude of that needs to be greater than 1, because if it's 1, you can see from this dashed line here, my noise margins would disappear. If I have no noise margins, errors accumulate, and we can't do digital logic with large numbers of gates. We also talked briefly about how this device operates when we switch it. When the input is low, we pump charge into the capacitor at the output node through the PMOS transistor. We store energy, 1/2 CV squared, in the capacitor. When the input goes high, we switch on the NMOS transistor. We pull all of that energy out. We dump it to ground, and we return the capacitor to zero. The time it takes to put the charge in is related to the on current of the PMOS. The time it takes to pull the charge out is related to the on current of the N-channel transistor. We showed that if we look at the power dissipation as we're putting energy in and then dumping the energy and dissipating it to ground, the power dissipation in this dynamic switching operation is proportional to frequency times capacitance times voltage squared. And there's a factor here, alpha, the activity coefficient, which represents the fraction of the time that this particular gate is switching. Okay. There's also static power when it's not switching. Then one of the two transistors is open circuited, depending on whether the input is low or high, but there's a leakage current that flows, and that leakage current leads to some static power dissipation. So CMOS speed and power are summarized here. Speed is determined by on current. Power, the power supply voltage, plays a very important role because dynamic power goes as voltage squared. Frequency plays a very important role. The faster we operate it, the more power we dissipate. In the static power, the standby power, when the circuit isn't doing any computing or the gates aren't switching, is determined by the leakage current or the off current of the device when current is not supposed to be flowing. Higher on current means higher speed. Faster operation means we consume more power. If we can do that at a lower power supply voltage, it means we consume less power. And more leakage is not desirable because more leakage means we dissipate more power when we're doing nothing. So we summarized 4 key figures of merit, 4 circuits of this type, and the 4 were on current, off current, subthreshold swing, and Dibble. We explained how we would extract these from a measured IV characteristic. The on current is simply the current when we apply the maximum voltage to the gate and the maximum voltage to the drain. The maximum voltage is the voltage we have available in the power supply. That current is the on current. We usually quote it in terms of microamps per micrometer of width so that we can scale it to transistors of different widths. We also talked about the off current. We extract the off current by plotting the transfer characteristic on a log plot. The off current is the current when there is 0 volts supplied between the gate and the source, but when there's a large voltage applied at the drain. The device is supposed to be off and conducting no current. There will always be some small current. That small current is the off current. Now, we also talked about the subthreshold swing, which is a measure of how much voltage does it take to go from off to on. We would like that voltage to be as small as possible because power dissipation goes as voltage squared. We'd like to minimize that power dissipation. So that transition is determined by the subthreshold swing of the transistor. The subthreshold swing of a transistor is how many millivolts we have to increase the gate voltage by in order to increase the drain current an order of magnitude. So we call that parameter the subthreshold swing, and we usually quote it in millivolts of gate voltage that it takes to increase the drain current a decade, millivolts per decade. And we talked about a very important point. We'll explain the physics later. You cannot have a subthreshold swing less than 60 millivolts per decade in a MOSFET. That's constrained by the physics of how a MOSFET operates. If you analyze measured characteristics and you find a number smaller than that, you've done something wrong. Or you've invented a new device and you'd better patent it immediately. The 4th metric is called Dibble. So the way we measure Dibble is, again, we look at the transfer characteristic on a logarithmic plot. We look at it at a high gate voltage. We look at, we look at a high drain voltage. We look at it at a low drain voltage. The two curves are translated parallel to each other. We define an arbitrary current in the sub-threshold regime. And then we ask ourselves, how much is the characteristic under high drain voltage translated to the characteristic under low drain voltage? That translation is drain-induced barrier lowering, called Dibble. Okay. And we usually measure that in millivolts per volt. So it's the number of millivolts shift in the gate voltage per volt change in the drain voltage in these two measurements. Okay, the lower the Dibble, the better. When we switch to analog, we had a couple of key important figures of merit. The maximum gain is an important figure of merit, and it consists of two key device metrics, transconductance and output resistance. Okay. So we multiply the two together, we get what's called the self-gain. That's the maximum gain that would be possible with this transistor in any type of single-stage amplifier circuit. The transconductance, you know, we can extract from a measured characteristic just by perturbing the gate voltage a little bit and seeing how much the drain voltage increases. The delta ID divided by the delta VG is the transconductance. We would make that delta small, and then we would have an estimate for the small signal transconductance, usually quoted in microsiemens per micrometer, sometimes millisiemens per micrometer, whatever is convenient. The output resistance is just a measure of the slope, actually the inverse slope of the current in the saturation regime. This reflects the fact that if we change the drain voltage a little bit, we'll get a change in the drain current. That change in drain current can be related to the output resistance R out. So the output resistance is just defined as 1 over the slope of the IV characteristic in the saturated regime. We would usually measure that in ohm-micrometers would be the appropriate units if we're measuring the current in micrometers per, say microamps per micrometer of width. Okay, so the analog device metrics then, the key ones that are easiest to estimate for a transistor characteristic are transconductance, output resistance. Multiply the two together, that gives us the self-gain. If the device looks like it's potentially interesting for analog applications, then we could dive deeper into some of the other metrics that are a little more involved to measure, FT, Fmax, linearity, noise, etc. Okay, so just to summarize, these are all terms now that you should be familiar with how they're defined, what they mean, not yet with what, you know, what causes them. That's what the course is about. But you should understand how you could take a measured IV characteristic and extract each one of these parameters. Our goal in the course is to understand these parameters. Where do they come from? What's causing them to have the values that they do? So then the final topic we talked about was just a quick introduction to compact models. And we talked about the fact that there will really be two that we will discuss. Most of the course is about compact physical models, models that capture the essence of the operation of the transistor and that we used for insight and understanding. All right, that's where our focus is. The second type of compact model, and what most people mean in electronics when they say the word compact model, is a simple analytical, usually model that is intended for use in circuit design and circuit simulation. Okay, so these kinds of compact models play a very important role. They're what allow circuit designers to design complex circuits. They connect the manufacturing process to the actual circuit design process, so they play a critically important role in technology development. So just to summarize, as you review Unit 1, be sure that you're familiar with the shape of the transistor characteristics, what we mean by the different regions, linear, saturation, sub-threshold, above threshold, what we mean by an output characteristic, a transfer characteristic. You should be familiar with these terms because we'll just be using them over and over again for the remainder of the course. You should also be familiar with these key device metrics and what they mean, how they're defined, and how to extract them from a measured IV characteristic. So next, in Unit 2, we will begin to look inside the black box and examine what goes on inside a transistor that leads to these particular IV characteristics and device metrics.